we couldn't develop what it is. If you don't have self-concern, you cannot have concern for others. This is impossible. But when you have bodhicitta, like Lama Zopa, for example, he's only there for the benefit of others. He never thinks about himself. No, and other masters also. When you have that, then it is okay to steal something when you, because then realizing emptiness, you can see far more. When you see that these people, the rich people, they have created so much negative karma, it would create, it would purify their negative karma if now I take the money away from them. Meaning you are also concerned with the happiness of the people that you do something. If a non-bodhisattva kind of does these negative actions of body and speech, not those of the mind, this nobody can do without it being negative. But if a non-bodhisattva does it, with thinking, you know, hiding behind the gratitude, then you get a lot of negative karma. But if you are realized, then you know, this is what we would like, isn't it? To be able to do all these negative actions with a good motivation, and then nothing will happen. But don't forget, you know, don't bring in your view of a creator God watching us. Because sometimes when we talk about karma, people ask me, if the situation is such and such and such, am I then allowed to steal or to kill or to whatever? Well, whom are you going to ask for permission? Whom are you going to ask for permission? Who can say, yes, you are allowed? Who?
Himself.
Nobody has the power to wash away your negative karma. You have to wash it away yourself. So, that's what I mean. So Robin Hood, maybe he was a bodhisattva, I don't know. But you see, again, who knows who is a bodhisattva? I know that I'm not. If other people are or are not, I don't know. And very often also with this word for bodhisattva, people sometimes see people being very compassionate and, you know, always working for others, and they say, oh, he or she is such a bodhisattva. We don't know, because with the bodhisattva, it's not just being very kind now to all others. The bodhisattva is somebody who understands, as long as I have not attained enlightenment, I cannot lead others to that state. So it's always these two aspirations. I want to benefit all sentient beings. That should come first. How can I do that when I myself become Buddha? So it is looking for enlightenment, not making life better in this worldly kind of thing. Okay? But in the meantime, whatever you can do to benefit others, you do it. Of course. So bodhisattva is not social. Okay? Bodhisattva is somebody then who knows these methods, how to lead people to enlightenment, works further on his mind until it's fully enlightened. I should divide my food amongst those who have fallen to the lowering arms, those without protection and practitioners, and eat merely what is sufficient for myself, except for the three robes I may give away all. Okay, this is for ordained people. So we are allowed to give everything away except the robes, so that we're not going around naked. Actually, also, there is, I wonder if already there's for 85 to 95 is the daily behavior for ordained people. So, if you're not ordained, it doesn't really concern you. Still, you can take it and this body which is being used for the sake of dharma should not be harmed for only slight benefit. But by my behaving this way, the wishes of all beings will be quickly fulfilled. So again, he is encouraging us again. Those who lack the pure intention of compassion should not give away their body, not give their body away. Instead, both in this and future lives, they should give it to the cause of fulfilling the great purpose. So if you're a dharma practitioner, a mosquito falls into a very wild river and you jump after it to save its life, but you can't swim, and then you use your life and even though your monk or nun that day is useless. You're not giving your life to somebody that you, that's what I mean. So if you are, if you haven't, if you don't know where you're going to be reborn, meaning if you haven't realized emptiness, and if you don't have control over where you will be reborn, then you keep your body as much as you can, and you take care of it, and you go to the doctor when you're sick, and you take the medicine that is being prescribed. And when it comes down to chemotherapy, when primary practitioners have cancer, very often, then first thing you do, you ask your master, what shall I do? Shall I go into therapy? Shall I not? And then you follow their advice. You're not making that decision, I'm not going to do anything alone, if you have a master. Because it could be healed, it might be difficult, but it could be healed. And also, even when you're sick, you know, you become an object of compassion for other people. You're not useless when you need help. You're actually very, very valuable for other people. And then the sickness can become great. You can advance a lot in your practice. We have people in the group in Bern who have had cancer. I mean, one, especially one of them, the way she dealt with her sickness is so amazing. It was so inspiring. You know, always seeing the good side, spontaneously. Always seeing the good side. That was the second time we found out she had cancer. She has a multiple myeloma, which is like, you know. And she says, even now, she says, I know it will come back. It's not, maybe it will come back. I know it will come back, but while, now, while I'm healthy, I enjoy life. Yeah. She practices, but she also goes to see a lot of friends. She went to New Zealand to see her brother and all this. Before the sickness, she was always depressed. It's really amazing. Then she understood how precious life is. And the, I tell you, the chemotherapy for multiple myeloma is heavy. She had to stay three weeks in the hospital, totally sterile room, because you shut down the immune system. So, so inspiring. So as a sick person, not complaining all the time, you can be so inspiring to offer such a good example that when then these people are sick, they can go, well, if they can do it, I can also do it. Do not think you're useless when you're sick. Okay, so if you don't have, if you haven't realized, if you don't have real compassion, don't give away your body. First you give away your food. You know, that's how you start. Also here it says in the verse before, I should divide my food, or just giving it away. We learn, like there's not enough food, so you give some of it away. There's not enough food for everybody, so instead of getting it and going to a corner and hiding and eating it, you share it. You know, I don't know. Will I be really generous if the food is lacking? I don't know. Will I be able to share the water when there's not enough water? Not sure. Yeah? Not sure. Maybe yes. Maybe not. Mother would. Mother would be able to give the water to the children or the food. Me? I hope so. I hope so. I hope so. I hope to, you know, and it's also with this thing of giving. I saw when my mom died, there was so little money left that we just divided it into four. I could have divided it into three because my brother was dead, so it was his two daughters and me. That was all that remained. But there's only something like 6,000 francs or something, 8,000. So I said, but I also have a sister-in-law, which by law she doesn't get anything. So I said, oh, let's divide it into four. Come on, because it's like, that's the family, so why? Why only three? Let everybody get 2,000 and that's it. Then I was thinking, wow, if there would have been a million left, would I have given 250,000 to my sister? I hope yes, I'm not sure. Do you see what I mean? Even though it's so much more, you know?
Why?
Yeah. Because, you know, I would have gone short on 250,000 francs. Going short of 2,000 is no big deal. That's how money, that's how you think when you don't have the money. That, but you have all this. You think totally differently when the sun gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. No. That's what I'm saying. If you try to be, or if you are in a situation like this at one point, like, it's so much easier to give little, you know, to share the little things when it's money. Of course, food, if there's too much food, then you're happy to share the little things. So yeah, I mean, I hope so. I hope I would have, but I'm not sure. I would have definitely thought about it longer than the 2,000 francs. Because by law, she has no right to get it. I mean, by law, I would have had the right to get 500,000 and the two kids, each one a 250,000. That would have been by law. But, yeah, yeah, it looks as if, oh, but then I have so much. But it's not bad because I've seen it. You know, when the brother got 800, no, somebody got 800,000 and the brother got 1.5 million, and he got so upset. It's no use telling to that person, but you have 800,000 francs, you know what you're doing with this. It's no use to say this at that moment. It's no use, because it's just, you know, I didn't get 400%. You can't imagine what goes on in heritages when there's money. So basically, you don't leave any money to the kids or if you have more than one. If you have one, it's just very cool. If you have more than one, it's just very cool.
With the problem with 88.
Hmm?
88.
You didn't get that.
88. The Dharma should not be, the Dharma should not be explained. Now, this is for the paying people, okay? The Dharma should not be explained for those who lack respect, to those who, like sick men, wear clothes around their heads, like the turbans, to those holding umbrellas, sticks or weapons, to those with covered heads. So, you know, so it's the same as it's cultural. Come on, don't freak out. It's okay, it's cultural. The same way as I am not allowed to go to the wailing wall with bare arms, or a man without a kippah, the same way you go into a temple, you bear your head. You're not wearing something on your head. Okay? That's why. Holding umbrella sticks or weapons is that nobody comes to kill you. Because you don't know how they will use the Dharma. If they come into the prayer hall or the soul, then you don't know how they're going to Okay. Nor to a woman unaccompanied by a man. Very cultural. It's very, very cultural. You know, this is from the 8th century. Yeah. And you still have today cultures where the women don't go out alone. They would feel very insecure. They would feel very happy if they would have to go out alone. The vast and profound should not be taught to less capable beings, although I should always pay equal respect to the dharmas of the lesser and higher beings. Okay, so everybody earns your respect, but there's certain, sometimes they say, sometimes people are not the right vessel to put the dharma in. Especially when they talk about the right motivation, also like with the two cups, one is like upside down, nothing goes in anyway, one is has holes, is leaking, and the other one has already a smell in it, and the smell in it would be when you study the Dharma in order to earn money with it, or to criticize it and to disparage it. So to those people we should not teach. Why? Because they create negative karma. So this here, this is very cultural. I should not communicate the Dharma of this kind. This we have done, yeah? Okay. Like also, why should I not teach Mahayana to somebody who is very firm in a Vipassana group? Because I make them confused. That is why. Because then it adds, you know, but still you should respect them. Because otherwise you can, also they give a Mahayana person the advice not to spend more than 7 days in the house of somebody who is doing Vipassana practices because they might weaken your own practice. Okay, do you see what I mean? Can you understand what this is all about? So that you are in one vehicle and then you continue with that vehicle and that's it. But as I said this morning, for me, the Vipassana and Mahayana, for me, it goes very well together. Still, you know which is my main vehicle. You only go to the other to get some more explanation, maybe on bodhicitta or compassion. If you're a Vipassana practitioner, you go to Mahayana, or you go to Mahayana and you go to the Vipassana people to train mindfulness and awareness.
As you said, when you described the foundation of the Ayurveda, it makes a lot of sense because you practice the four noble truths and the real basic.
Yeah, you need to know that.
Yeah, and it's like the basic for
bodhicitta and everything. That's totally the basis. That's why it is also taught in the Mayan tradition. Mm-hmm. You know, in the Mayan tradition, it's not only that we only start with bodhicitta. Now, of course, it's starting with bodhicitta, but the next one, the numbering course, will start with four noble truths, gracious human rebirth, impermanence, and death, karma, and yoga. That's the foundation. Okay. I should not communicate the Dharma of less capable being to one who is a vessel for the vast Dharma. I must not forsake the Bodhisattva way of life, nor mislead others by means of sutras and mantras. So don't confuse them again. If they are in one vehicle, then when it's also still for ordained people, okay? When I spit or throw away the stick for cleaning my teeth. How many of you have been to India? Did you see how they clean their teeth?
They do it?
Okay, they have to use the neem tree, N-E-E-M. It's a tree that is only medicine, the bark, the leaves, the inside, the flowers, I don't know. But then they take these twigs, and then they go all day, they go like this, in the street, everywhere, they have this stick. You haven't seen them?
Yes, I remember that.
Okay. So this is, you should not throw that stick out. You should not spit. I should cover it up with earth, that stick. Also, it is shameful to urinate and so forth in water or on land used by others. Well, for us, we would say, India is like everybody shits outside. Many people. Although Gandhi desperately tried to teach them to use latrines, but they think it's a dirty place, I don't want to go in there. So again, that culture of going out in the morning with your little bucket into the field. If you travel on a train and you wake up early and you look out the window, all you see is bare butts, kind of not looking at, not having the bottom towards the sun. Because that's disrespectful, so that's the Hindus. So when you make a kaka in the field, your behind needs to be away from the sun. So they're all facing the same direction. The sun is there, the face is there, the bum goes this way, so you see rows of bum. This is India. And then they have a little bucket with them where they wash themselves afterwards, and not paper. Which is a good thing, because the kaka kind of disintegrates after a while, whereas toilet paper doesn't. They say, what do you do with paper? That's so dirty. What do you mean? Or the handkerchiefs also, they go, you sneeze in it and then you put it in your pocket? First day they go like this. Yeah. And speak, there's a lot of speaking in it. Then again, how do we eat? Behaviors, we still with the behavior for months and months. When eating, I should not fill my mouth, eat noisily or with my mouth wide open. I should not sit with my legs outstretched, nor rub my hands together. I see the food and go, I'm really looking forward. This is for ordained people, because it's all against attachment. So actually, ordained people should not even make a remark how the food is. In the monastery, okay? When we're private people, it's different. You should never say good, not good, whatever. So we have a lot of rules when it comes down to how to behave. Yeah. Also, simple stuff when I eat, then I fill the spoon, usually just the spoon, put it in the mouth, then I put the spoon down until the mouth is empty. I know, you know, things like not to throw food in the air, catching it. Yeah, this we have. This is why we have so many vows. So some of them are really not complicated, but I just behave. I should not sit alone in vehicles, upon beds, nor in the same room with a woman of others. That's for the monks. For me, it's a man. So I should actually never be. I break vows when I'm traveling with a man, only a man in the car. I break vows when somebody comes to see me and the door is closed, like that. So don't be surprised. I'm not, as I'm saying, it's minor vows, okay? It's not big vows. But they are really there for protection. Because now also we have all these, now also in the Tibetan tradition coming out, sexual abuse, sexual harassment and all this. If that rule would be kept, it could never happen. If a monk or a nun is never alone with either a woman or a man, nobody can accuse you. Because you can also get accused falsely. And this is what happened in Dharamsala. I mean, I'm pretty sure that the woman accused him falsely, and then he gave up his vows and he disappeared. But I'm pretty sure that because she wanted to seduce him, and he didn't pay attention to her, and then she accused him of having harassed her sexually. I know him really well, and I'm sure he didn't do anything. So I'm sure. I know her and I know him, so yeah, but if you're never alone with a person of the other sex in the room, nobody can accuse you because there's always a witness. So this is why, this is not because no, you're not allowed to. This is for protection. And also monks and vows, they have celibacy vows. So you know, me, my age, I wouldn't need a celibacy vow. When I took the vow, I was 40, so I still have the sexual energy still kind of. I was dead. Which I'm very happy.
You know, in Israel for Hasidic people, very religious people, when a woman and a man have to let the
door open.
And for example, in university, a teacher in university now used to let don't have a private conversation with a woman. And closing the door, they let a little bit the door open.
Yeah, exactly.
No matter if the girl, the
yeah,
teacher is religious or not religious, it's now they do that in the university.
That's a very good thing. I mean, this is when they said, I can be with a man alone in a public place. And it becomes a public place when everybody has access, when everybody can just walk in.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why also then, if I'm alone in the room with a man, I leave the door. So don't be surprised if you know you go and talk to a monk or to a master and they leave the door open. That's why they do. Or take somebody with you. This is the best. I mean, this is really the best. It's okay for a man to be in a room with two women,
yeah,
or for me to be in a room with two men. Then that's also fine, right. Not just one and one. I should not give directions with one finger, but instead indicate the way respectfully with my right arm with all my fingers fully outstretched. So this is what, you know, when a Tibetan shows you the way, they always go, it's this way. They never go, it's this way. Yeah? Or they also say, it's your fault. Because when they say, it's your fault, then the other one says, oh, you have one finger going there and three fingers going here. So this, for them, it's very disrespectful to go like this. You know? The same thing, you know, here in Israel, when somebody says rega, yeah, it's okay. You have this in Italy.
Oh,
really? Yeah, you better be careful. You also, don't talk to these kind of things. So we have to be careful with our body language. So this is the Tibetan or the Asian people actually. They never go like this. They always go like when they show some things. I mean, you can again ask why. I don't know why, it's just convention. Nor should I wildly wave my arms about, but should make my point with slight gestures and snap of the fingers, otherwise I shall lose control. Yeah, I have to remember that one. Just as the Buddha lay down to pass away, so should I lie in his eye direction when going to sleep, But first of all, my alertness make a firm decision to quickly rise again. You go to sleep on your right side, because one thing is you sleep better, because then you're not lying on your heart, on your physical heart, and you have your right hand on your right cheek, and that would be the perfect way to die. So if you go to bed like this, then also when you are about to die, you have the habit of lying in that direction, and they say it's easier for the mind to then absorb into the clear light and come out and so forth. So again, it's a, also, you know, lying down in that, that position, you could think that maybe I will not wake up. And then you think tomorrow morning I wake up quickly, I will arrive. So there's not this, you know, 5 minutes, 2 minutes. I'm sure none of you think that. You know, the alarm clock goes and then you go, wow, great, I'm still alive. Let me start the day with a bright mood. Although I am unable to practice all. Yeah, so there he says, you know, he says to himself, I'm not practicing, not able to practice all of this. The limitless varieties of bodhisattva conduct, I should certainly practice as much as has been mentioned here of this conduct that trains the mind. So there are easy things to do, so we should start with doing the easy things and not saying, oh, this is not important. Okay? This is a skillful way of training, about training easy things. Okay. Then, 98, 3 times a day and 3 times by night, I should recite the sutra in the 3 sections. For relying upon Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, my remaining downfalls will be purified. This is making prostrations to the 35 Buddhas. The sutra is called the Sutra of the 3 Heaps. Here he's telling everybody what kind of texts to recite. So that is it's very powerful for purification. Because why 3 heaps? Because you recite the names of the 35 Buddhas, then you have confession, then you have rejoicing, and then you have dedication in that sutra. It's, how long is it? 20 minutes? 20 minutes to do. As long as you can still prostrate, do it, you know, because the time will come like me where you cannot prostrate anymore. And I really regret that I can't do it anymore, because it does cleanse your channels. Cleanses your nervous system. It's a bit like yoga, yeah? But yoga with the deeper purpose of also purifying the mind. This, you know, going up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. If you go to Pagaya, you see many people prostrating around the street. Whatever I am doing in any situation, whether for myself or for the benefit of others, I should strive to put into practice whatever has been taught for that situation. So, check the situation, what is appropriate, what is not appropriate, what should be abandoned, what should be enhanced. So again, mindfulness, alertness, constantly. There is no such thing as something that is not learned by a conqueror's son. It can also be a daughter, okay? Conqueror's son is like conqueror's child, it's like bodhisattva. Thus, if I'm skilled in living in this way, nothing will be non-meritorious. So whatever you do with bodhicitta, it becomes, I think it gets a lot of merit. Like when they say, you know, just the thought of wanting to liberate, alleviate the headache of one person creates positive energy. Or like you as a doctor, you create so much positive energy by healing people. I mean, such a wonderful job. But then by, it's not just doing it, but by thinking, I will liberate all sentient beings from their suffering. I mean, that's tremendous, just that thought, the amount of merit that it creates. Yeah. But it has to be genuine, it has to be, you should mean it and not just say it. Yeah, when you say, I want to attain enlightenment for the benefit of all sentient beings. So this is why, even while you sleep, as a bodhisattva, you create positive energy, you create merit. Whatever directly or indirectly, I should not do anything that is not for the benefit of others, and solely for the sake of sentient beings, I should dedicate everything towards awakening of others. That's why we dedicate all the time. Never, even at the cost of my life, should I forsake a spiritual frame.